way from Iceland, Andrew Magnusson is a writer, a novelist, well known for his non-fiction book, Dreamland, that takes a look at Iceland's industrial and energy policy. And his latest book, On Time and Water, has been translated into 30 different languages. Ladies and gentlemen, help me in welcoming Andrew Magnusson to the stage. Welcome. Welcome to Estoril. How are you doing this
morning?
Thank
you very much. Thank
you. Lovely to see you. Let's find out a little bit more about you by taking a look at a short video.
Hi, my name is Andri Snær Magnusson, talking from Iceland. In 2019, we had lost our first glacier to climate change, the Ókjökull, the Ok glacier that is not okay anymore. And in the next 200 years, we expect all our glaciers to follow the same path. This glacier here is one of them, Sólheimajökull in the south coast of Iceland. I wrote a poem for a plaque that was placed on the mountain where Ókjökull once stood. It was a letter to the future, and it says, "This monument is to acknowledge that we know what is happening and what needs to be done. Only you know if we did it." My grandparents, they were glacial explorers at times when the glaciers seemed eternal. They went on a glacial honeymoon in the year 1956. For 3 weeks, they were mapping and traveling Vatnajökull, Europe's biggest glacier, sleeping in tents in extreme temperatures. And I asked them once, "Weren't you cold?" And they said, "Cold? We were just married." My grandmother just turned 96, and now we know that many glaciers will be gone within the time someone is born today, becoming as old as my grandmother is now. We need to start connecting to the future in an intimate and urgent way. My grandmother, she was born in the year 1924. And if I have grandchildren, the people I will love the most in my life will still be alive in the year 2150. Because our time is the time of the people that we know and love, the time that created us, and our time is also the time of the people that we will know and love, the time that we create. We can easily span 230 years, the handshake of generations. When a scientist says 2100, we just shrug. We don't feel connected. But I asked my grandmother, are 100 years a long time or a short time? And she said, to my surprise, it's a short time. I feel like I was traveling the glaciers yesterday. So 2100 is not a distant future. It's basically tomorrow, because in the mind of those people, 2020 will be yesterday. And I'm quite sure that we want them to look at our time with pride and gratitude, because we knew what was happening and we know what needs to be done. And we actually eventually did the right thing. Thank you.
Okay, the floor is now yours.
You.
Hello, everyone. It's a great honor to be here in Portugal. So my role as a writer and concerning this issue, sometimes called climate change, is to struggle with the fact that the issue is in many ways larger than language. What I mean with larger than language, that is, the words that we're trying to use are in a way meaningless. I can say a sentence, for example, in the year 2100, we expect the pH level of the world oceans to drop from 8.1 to 7.7 and that is the greatest change in the world oceans for 50 million years. Sorry, I said this. I just said a full sentence. And this is actually one of the most dramatic sentences a human being can say. And actually, in world history, nobody could have said this. But strangely, every single word that I said is meaningless. 2100, for my generation, we were raised with the year 2000 as the future. Most of my friends still believe 1970 was 30 years ago. And we can raise our hands. Who believes 1970 was 30 years ago? I think in a very strange way, we are disconnected with this century. I think most people in Glasgow, in a subtle way, believe 2050 is after 50 years, and 2100, that's just 81 years after Blade Runner, it's Hunger Games, it doesn't relate to us. The pH level, how can I tell you that 0.4 or 0.3 is the biggest number imaginable? How can I tell you it's an explosion? I could try lay on the floor, cry or something, but how can I translate that? And then 50 million years, that's 50 gazillion, 50 quadrillion, it's meaningless also, it's too big. So how can we talk about an issue where language basically fails us, but we're actually in a paradigm shift? So my work has been quite a lot about trying to translate this science into some kind of a human understanding. The plaque that we put on the glacier was one of them. If we look at history, then we're in unprecedented times when it comes to history, because world leaders, and some world leaders are here in this room, they have never met in history to discuss how they are melting glaciers. I think the Bible recalls when Moses split the Red Sea, but that is quite small compared to raising the world oceans by 1 meter. So we did not have Ramses II, Napoleon, Genghis Khan, or Caesar, or anybody discussing sea level 0.4, 0.5 meters. They did not talk about that. So we're in an unprecedented time of humans against nature. We're in a paradigm shift, and in paradigm shifts, you go against the norm, you go against the language, you go against reality, you go against what you're historically used to. My grandmother, she went through one of these paradigm shifts as a young woman born 1924. Her dream was to fly, and they did not expect women to fly, but she still decided she wanted to fly, she wanted to do what her brothers did. And when you break the norm, you actually go against the language. So a very small idea of how language changes is her flight certificate says born as a man, and they had to mark out and change it into born as a woman. A paradigm shift is something that we recognize from history books, and it can take 100 years for a new paradigm to be acknowledged and understood. Like the theory of Copernicus took almost a century to be widely accepted. And a new scientific truth does not triumph by convincing its opponents and making them see the light, but rather because its opponents eventually die and a new generation grows up that is familiar with it, said Max Planck. It took us about 100 years to understand the concept of democracy, and then it took us another 100 years to understand the concept of women's rights. Only last year we had an equally elected parliament, even though women had been half of the voters for 100 years. So only last year we achieved this goal, but now this parliament in Iceland, this is the Icelandic parliament, it's 50-50, men and women, they are again faced with another paradigm shift. That is, they're faced with words that parliaments before never had to deal with. They have to understand issues like ocean acidification, which is a term that was never mentioned in textbooks in their childhood, not even in their history books, not even in their university studies. This word was only created in 2004, first mentioned in Iceland in 2006, only once, 2006, and maybe 5 times mentioned in Icelandic media until 2012. And that also refers to global media. So what is ocean acidification? It's basically global warming's evil twin. It's the fact that 30% of the world's emissions end in the oceans. And in the next 80 years, because 2100 is after 80 years, not 100 years, we expect the world ocean's pH level to drop more than has been seen in 50 million years. And this is a paradigm shift. That is, when we see a graph like this, we understand that we never intended this to happen. We were making all sorts of things, we were having all sorts of dreams, making products, we were planning, and I think every single generation believes they were planning for the future. But suddenly we're confronted with something like this, and we have to reconsider, rethink almost everything that we've been doing for the last 50 or 100 years. Almost all our culture, all our business, all our values have to be rethought because this was something we never expected to happen. So only this is a paradigm shift, and the scale of nature leaving geological speed, entering human speed, is so enormous that we're talking about a single human being born today, becoming as old as my grandmother, is seeing a greater change in the world oceans than not only all of the ancestors of man, but 10 times the whole evolution of humanity. And that is a mythological event. And this is man entering a stage where only comets, earthquakes, and volcanoes had before. So this paradigm shift is so big that it should change almost all, confront all our political beliefs, all our textbooks, all our studies, and our law also, because it should actually be illegal for a generation to make such dramatic change on the world oceans. So in a paradigm shift, you're either part of the change or you're hit by the change. And we can see this in terms of glaciers as well, because my grandparents, they were measuring the glaciers for 50 years, and we can apply that to modern science of the future of the glaciers. And we can see how the major glaciers of Iceland have left geological speed and entered human speed of change, and will be largely vanished within the time of 2160. And what does this mean? Again, this is a paradigm shift. This is a fundamental change of us against the planet. This is a call for change, but why do we not understand a term like 2160? Just like I said in this talk before, my daughter, she's 20. She will reach the age of my grandmother in the year 2100. She might have a favorite 20-year-old in her life, somebody born 2080. That person will become 90 in the year 2170. So most of the students in here, they will actually know and love somebody deeply that is still out there in the year 2140, 50, even 60. And this is not just an abstract sci-fi thing, this is just the general continuity of generations. So what does this mean for the purpose generation? That means that every single job that you choose, all your working life is about this issue. Everything that you choose, everything that you design, will be in the light of this. If you go into food, farming, all farming, food industry has to change, food waste. If you go into transportation, all transportation has to change so much in the next 30 years that our transportation today should be unrecognizable from what it was. If you go into fashion, fashion waste, fashion has to change, technology. If you go into energy, there's this huge, enormous challenge in terms of energy. So you can also frame this as for the purpose generation, that they might be unlucky. Many of them frame it as being unlucky to be born today, but it was a challenge to be born in Europe in 1940. It was a challenge to be born in 1900. It is a challenge to be born today. But the thing is that we have already all the inventions, all the technology, and it can be a very stimulating, interesting time to be a generation that basically has to enter the workforce and change everything for 30 years. And that is intellectually stimulating, it's politically, scientifically, culturally, it can be a very interesting 30 years that lie ahead in basically reversing all this. So anyone should do their own calculations. When is someone still alive that you will love? Just take your age, imagine you will become as old as your grandmother, and imagine you will meet and love a 20-year-old, and imagine that person reaching a wise old age. When is someone still alive that you will love? It can be 2,120, 2,150. Anyone just do that calculation. Thank you very much.